Right, a very good evening to you guys. Today we are going to solve certain problems based on commutators, right? Now these problems are very essential for you to practice because in the exam especially, a lot of questions are asked from commutators, right? Right from your easy ones to your difficult ones. So the easy ones I have discussed in my previous video where I had explained the physical significance of commutators and I had discussed some examples as well, like your position operator and your momentum operator, right? I had taken a commutator and shown you that it is not equal to zero, and I had told you the significance of that particular fact, right? And then I had taken some small I had taken x operator and d by dx. These two operators also I had taken and shown you that the commutator is not zero. Now I'll take certain complex commutators of two different operators and show you that how it's done, right? Now these questions are based from your CSI NET exam, your GATE exam, and several other exams from your academic exams as well, because in the academic exams as such these questions can be asked, right? Now these are the questions I have written for my reference, which I'm going to discuss in today's video. So this video is going to be pretty long, right, because of this fact. And let's see, I don't want the video to be very long as well, so let's see how many of them we can discuss, or otherwise I'll divide it into two parts, okay, this particular video. And these problems, after you solve these problems, these are the most complex ones that can be asked in the exam. You would have no problem at all in commutators, that I can guarantee you. All right, so now let's just dive into the first particular question. And the first question is basically your commutator between your kinetic energy and your momentum in x direction, right? So first we are going to solve is your kinetic energy, that is denoted by the symbol T, and since I've written as Tx and a hat, that means it's an operator. T is basically kinetic energy operator in x direction, okay? This is how you represent it. And then momentum in x direction operator, so we have to solve the commutator of kinetic energy and potential energy in x direction. Px and Tx means in x direction. All right, now I told you that you have to remember in the previous video, I told you that you have to remember the operator for momentum. The operator for momentum is basically your h cross by I del by del x, right? Del by del x. This is the momentum operator, okay? And if you have to derive the kinetic energy operator, you don't need to mug up what is the kinetic energy operator. You just need to know what's the momentum operator. From the momentum operator, you can derive the kinetic energy operator. How will you do that? Basically, in classical mechanics, your kinetic energy is basically equal to p square by 2m, okay? So all you have to do is take, instead of this classical mechanical relation, if you need to find the operator for kinetic energy, you just take kinetic energy operator, which I can represent by kinetic energy and a hat on top, then which is equal to potential energy, linear momentum operator square upon 2m. So what you need to do is square this whole operator and divide by 2m. So if I square this whole operator and divide by 2m, I get the kinetic energy operator, which is basically your h cross square upon 2m, since I'm dividing by mass, and del square by del x square, okay? And what else I am doing is basically I'm taking a minus sign, because if I square iota, that is your imaginary under root minus 1, if I square under root minus 1, I get minus 1. So that's why I'm having a negative sign over here. So momentum operator, we derived our kinetic energy operator, all right? Now let's solve this commutator. So how do we solve this commutator? Basically, first we'll take the wave function, okay? Let's take the wave function psi. So basically, first the momentum operator is acting on psi, all right? And then your potential, your kinetic energy operator is acting on psi, right? So this can be written as basically Tx operator, Px operator acting on psi minus of Px operator, Tx operator, psi, okay? And just for the sake of convenience, I'm not going to write it as Tx and Px. You should understand that basically Tx, and if I write it as T operator only, that means in x direction, all right? Okay, so now let's just solve this. So first I write down the kinetic energy operator, which we found out was h cross square minus I h cross square by 2m del square by del x square, okay? In this was our kinetic energy operator into our momentum operator. Momentum operator is basically h cross upon I del by del x, and we are taking the wave function psi. So del psi by del x, okay? This I'll take in a square bracket so that we don't get confused. Minus of, again I'll put the square brackets. Now we write the momentum operator first, that is h cross upon I del by del x, and then into this hole into your kinetic energy operator, which is acting on the wave function psi. So we have minus of h cross square upon 2m del square psi by del x square. This is what we are going to get. Now if you solve this, h cross and h cross, this is constant, so we can take them on one side. So minus, so this equals to minus h cross whole cube upon 2mi, okay, into what? Into basically we are taking del square by del x square and del psi by del x. So this whole, if we multiply, we get del cube by del x cube psi. This is what we're going to get. This, so this is our LHS, you can say, right? Minus of, now we'll solve this. This is basically, again, if we multiply this, this becomes minus of minus h cross whole cube upon 2mi, again d by dx multiplied by del square psi by del x square will give us basically del cube upon del x cube psi. Okay, now minus minus, if two minuses are there, then this becomes plus. So minus of minus becomes plus. So this whole becomes nothing but plus this value. Now if you see, these two are the same values. So if you solve this, the commutator comes out to be zero. Alright, so the commutator of your kinetic energy and your momentum is zero, and that means that they both can be simultaneously determined. Alright, so this is a physical significance. So your kinetic energy, if someone asks you your momentum and kinetic energy, you can simultaneously determine it. Now if you want, if you are short of time, let's say you have 20 seconds or even 10 seconds and you do not have the time to answer this particular question, what is the trick that you can use? There's a very simple trick. Now your kinetic energy is basically equal to p square upon 2m. M is a constant. Alright, mass is a constant value. So mass of a particle you always know, be it a microscopic particle or a macroscopic particle, the mass is always fixed, right? For if you're talking about an electron has a fixed mass, a proton has a fixed mass. So let's say if you are trying to determine the kinetic energy and the linear momentum of an electron, the mass will always be fixed. So kinetic energy is basically dependent on the mass and the momentum. And if we are trying to find out the commutator of momentum and kinetic energy, and if you can with very precise value determine the momentum of a particular electron, then obviously the kinetic energy you'll know, because you just have to divide it by mass. So if you know the momentum, it's for sure that you'll know the kinetic energy. So if you take out the commutator, it is always going to be zero, because you can obviously find out from your momentum what is the kinetic energy. So if you can determine the momentum of a particle, of an electron, then obviously you can determine this kinetic energy at the same time. Alright, so this is a good logical way by which, if you do not even have the time to solve the commutator, solving the commutator is always a safe choice. But let's say you do not have the time, then in that particular case you can think logically and come out with the answer. Alright, okay, so now let's take another example. Okay, now let's take a little this example actually was posted on my group also, that is the Reagent Blues group. So I have a Facebook group called Reagent Blues, and in that particular group I had discussed this question. I mean, I had not discussed this question, this particular question was asked, so I thought I'll solve this particular question as well. The question is basically, it's a little tricky one. So you have x operator, it's easy but it's tricky, x operator, and then we have again x operator px. So we have two commutators, one commutator we have in this bracket, and then we have another commutator which we'll obtain after solving this commutator. So sometimes students get confused which commutator to solve first. So obviously it's basically basic mathematics, so whichever brackets is inside, you first solve that particular problem. So this bracket is inside the big brackets, so first you solve this commutator x and px. Now this commutator we had solved in our previous video and the answer came out to be I h cross. The answer came out to be I, H cross. All right. So what you do is basically, if you don't know how to solve, it's very, very basic, right? You can just solve by the method that I had told you just now. Even if you have not seen my previous video, though, I recommend you to go and see my previous video, because there I have discussed the physical significance, which I'm sure you would not find in any other video, and you would find in books, but you know, you might skip it because the books are very, very lengthy. So I've just taken the gist of that particular the whole topic basically, and shown in that particular video. Anyway, so X operator, and then so the commutator of X operator and PX operator is basically I H cross. So basically what we are solving is X operator and I H cross. Now we'll do the same trick. Even I know the answer is going to be zero because there is a constant over here, so it is going to be zero, but let's just solve. Let's say you do not know and we need to solve. So we take the wave function psi. So X operator is nothing but multiplication by X. So we have, first we'll have I H cross acting on this wave function, and then we'll have operator X acting on this wave function. Okay, so I'll write down over here X operator into I H cross, and this is psi, okay, minus of I H cross X operator acting on psi. X operator acting on psi. So if X operator is acting on psi, that means multiplication by X. So this X operator acting on wave function psi is nothing but your it's nothing but X operator acting on psi is nothing but multiplication by X. So we can just write it as X psi, or I'll write down in the next step. Now X operator acting on this whole function, so this is nothing but I H cross. I can take on the outside I H cross, I can take on the outside since it's constant. So I H cross X operator acting on wave function psi minus of I H cross act X operator acting on psi. So we can cancel this out, so the answer comes out to be zero. So the correct answer for this question was zero. This came in, I think, CSI NET December 2015 exam. I don't know if it came for 2 marks or 4 marks, but very simple question. Hardly took you 30 seconds to solve this question, right? So it looked complicated. I mean, it didn't look complicated, but it was different than what you generally practice. All right. Okay. So two problems we have solved, which is your X and this one, and then we have solved this one as well. Okay, so now let's move on to some other problems. Okay, one very interesting problem that I have come up with is X operator acting on PX square of momentum. Now if you solve this by the usual method that you use, it will become very difficult to it will take a lot of time. It will not become difficult, it will be still easy, but it will take a lot of efforts to come up with the answer. All right, now how do you do such kind of questions? So there's basically, I don't know why, but I have not seen this in many books, this particular relation when we are talking about commutators. So I'm going to teach you a very important relation that is very useful for you when it comes to the exams. All right, and that relation is basically your A operator comma B operator C operator. If you're trying to solve this commutator, so we have A operator and we have B operator and C operator. If you're trying to solve this particular commutator, how do you solve it is basically what you do is take this B operator on the left and this C operator on the right. So you take the B operator on the left and C operator on the right. Okay, this is how I remember this particular formula. You don't have to do anything. Just take this B operator on the left and this take this C operator on the right. Now if I take this B operator on the left, what do I get? B operator commutator of A operator and C operator. Okay, what did I do? I took this B operator and took it on the left side. So I got B operator, which is equal to which B operator into commutator of, if I take B operator outside on the left, what am I left with? A operator and C operator, right? Plus, now I have taken the C operator on the right hand side. So now it becomes A operator comma B operator commutator and then multiplied by C operator. And this is the formula. So if you have commutator of A operator comma B operator and C operator, then you can write it down as basically this. And how can you, if you want, you can mug it up, but this is the way I have remembered it and becomes very easy to understand this way. So basically what you do is take the B operator on the left and take the C operator on the right. Right, so the two operators that are coming together, you take one on the left and one on the right. Okay, nothing you have to do. Basically, after the comma, we have two operators which are together. You take one of the operators on the left and take the other one on the right. Okay, the one that is on the end, you take it on the right, and the one which is in the middle, you take it on the left, and then you get this kind of relation. So this is nothing but your important commutator relationship, which we are going to use to solve this particular question. Okay, and actually I have a very short trick to solve this this problem, very short trick. Okay, but I want you to first solve this particular question, then I'll teach you that trick as well, because these tricks I'm definitely planning a crash course during your June exam. I'm planning it. I'm not sure if I'll be able to pull it off or not, where I'll teach you all these short tricks that I have with me. All right. Okay, so you're going to use this relation to solve this particular problem. Okay, now x operator px square. So how can we write this operator to make it in that particular form? I can write this operator as nothing but x operator px operator. Again, I'll write it down as p operator only, so that it avoids confusion. P operator into p operator. So p operator square, I can write it down as p operator into p operator, right? Now you can see it rhymes with that particular formula, the one that I had just told you, right? Where we had a operator, so your x operator is basically your a operator, and we have two p operators. So one p operator you can take to be b, and the other p operator you can take to be c. So how do we solve it? X operator comma p operator and p operator. So how do we solve this? You take one on the left and one on the right. So what do you get? You get p operator brackets x operator comma p operator. P operator means px. I have not written it down, but it's understood, right? Plus, now you take this p operator on the right. So we get x operator comma p operator, okay, and p operator on the right multiplied by p operator. So commutator of p operator multiplied by commutator of x operator p operator plus x commutator of x operator p operator multiplied by your p operator. Now if you solve this, what do you get? X operator p operator we have already known, it's how much? I h cross. So p operator multiplied by I h cross plus I h cross multiplied by p operator, right? So what do we get? We get 2p operator I h cross. This is our answer. Very easy. With the help of the relation, we got the answer in how much time? I think 20 seconds, 25 seconds max, right? And if you had solved this by the regular method, it would take you about 4-5 minutes, all right? Maybe less, but around that time. So you have almost saved 2-3 minutes of your time when you are solving such questions. So this is a relation that is important. Now let me tell you the shortcut relation that I was talking about, okay? So the shortcut relation is that your x operator comma p operator to the power n. Again, I'll not write down x. It's basically understood that I'm talking about p x operator. If I'm all right, whenever I'm writing p operator, it means I'm talking about the p x operator. That is momentum in x direction. That's why the formula becomes h cross by I d by dx. Okay, if in case I'm writing down over here y, then this will become d by dy. And excuse me, if I'm writing as z, then it will become d by dz. But right now I'm talking about only one dimensional. That's why I'm writing it as px. That means only in one direction. If I talk only p operator like this, then the formula will become h cross by I d by dx, d by dy, and d by dz. So this is in three dimensions, but right now for simplification sakes, generally in books also you will see it only in one dimension. Once we understood one dimension properly, then we will move on to the three dimensional quantum mechanics as well, right? Okay, so that's why what I was saying was that if I am writing it as x, that means if I'm not writing it as x, it's basically understood that it's in x direction. So the formula was so if you solve this commutator, the answer comes out to be n, okay, ni h cross p to the power n minus 1 p operator to the power n minus 1. This is the formula. Now how this formula is going to help you? Take any value of n. So here we had got the answer 2p I h cross, Okay, we had got this as the answer. So here n is equal to 2. This is the same case where n is equal to 2, right? So if you put n equal to 2 in this case, it becomes 2 I h cross p operator n minus 1. So 2 minus 1 becomes 2 p operator. We get this answer. Simple. This is the formula n I h cross p to the p operator n to the power n p to the p operator to the power n minus 1. If I take n equal to 1, that is x operator and p operator. We solved it, it is equal to I h cross. So I'll take n equal to 1. So this becomes I h cross. I take n equal to 1 and p operator n minus 1 minus 1. This will become p operator to the power 0. Anything to the power 0 will become 1. So our answer comes out to be I h cross. And that is exactly what we had got when we had derived the using the commutator relation. So this is the shortcut formula which will be very, very useful for you in the exam. Alright? Okay. Now to gain your confidence and for you to gain confidence in yourself, I'm going to help you solve a physics commutator problem that came in CSI NET 2012 for 4 marks. It came in CSI NET December 2012 for 4 marks, and that's a problem from physics. Alright, it's not from chemistry. So if you are able to solve the problem from physics, then definitely any chemistry problem based on commutators, you will have no problem at all. And that particular problem is basically x square comma px operator square commutator. Sorry, this we had already solved. This we have to solve. So over there we had x operator comma px operator square, but now we also have square of x operator. How are we going to solve this? Now this might seem to be very complicated, but it is not. So we'll use the same relation that we had used earlier, that a operator, b operator, c operator relation. So first I'll write down this px x operator. How can we write it down as? We can write it down as x operator into x operator and comma px operator square, right? I can write it down as this. Okay, let me just rub it off because it might take some space, so that's why I'll write it down a little more to the right. So we had x, I think you can see that, yeah, x operator comma x operator into x operator comma px operator square. This is how I can write it down as. Now I'll do the same thing what we had done earlier. Take x operator on the left and this x operator on the right. Now remember, I had taken a operator comma b operator c operator. Here we have a operator b operator comma c operator, right? So whenever you get where the two operators are together, like over here we have two operators together and then the comma, so you take these operators on the left and right. Alright, so you take these operators on the left and right. So the form, I'll just clarify one thing. Over there I had written a operator comma b operator c operator. So here b operator and c operator were together. The comma was a operator comma b operator and c operator. So that's why I was taking b operator and c operator on the left and right. But in case we have the formula like this, a operator b operator comma c operator, which is the case over here, then I'll take a operator on the left and b operator on the right. It depends which two operators are together, there I have to take left and right, right? Okay, so we'll solve this. So this becomes equal to, I'll take this once on the left and once on the right. So we have, and this left and right, it matters a lot because it's in classical mechanics, no matter how you multiply two functions or two variables or two values, it comes out to be same, but it is not the case in quantum mechanics. So in quantum mechanics, you have to be careful of how you're multiplying, whether you're multiplying the left first, right afterwards, or right first, left afterwards. It matters a lot in quantum mechanics. All right. So we have x operator on the left hand side, commutator of x operator comma px operator whole square, okay, plus, sorry, square, not whole square, square, sorry, plus, I hope you can see, yeah, plus we have, again, we'll take x operator comma px operator whole square on the right, okay, and on the right, we'll multiply it by x operator, okay. I hope this was easy, okay. Now what we are going to do, we can write this px. Now we can write this whole thing and this whole thing again. We can open it and write it in the same form. We can write it down as x operator into x operator comma px operator into px operator. So for simplicity sake, I'll not write down the x, plus x operator p operator p operator x operator, right? Again, I've written down as the same thing. Now again we'll solve it. So we'll take p once on the left, once on the right. Over here also we'll take p once on the left, once on the right. So what do we get? X operator, okay, sorry, p operator x operator, commutator of x operator comma p operator, plus, now I'll take p operator on the right. I'm solving for this first, okay? So we are taking p operator on the right, so this becomes x operator commutator of x operator comma p operator, and then p operator on the right. So this we have solved, okay? Just look at this carefully, just pause the video in case you're not able to understand, and just look carefully. So right now we have solved this. So this I'm going to rub it off so that it becomes easy and for you to comprehend, okay? Now again, I'll solve for this one. So for this one, we have p operator on the right, or I'll write down over here only. So p operator on the right, commutator of x operator, p operator, and then we have the x operator. Or x operator was already there, right? So we have to write the x operator as well. Plus, now we'll take this p operator on the right. So we have plus x operator, commutator of x operator and p operator, and then we have your x operator p operator, right? This is what we are going to get. So all these x operators and p operators, commutators, I can replace by ih cross, because we know the commutator of x operator and p operator is nothing but ih cross. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to replace it by ih cross. So here I'll write ih cross. Here also I'll write ih cross. Here also I'll write ih cross, okay. Now what I'll do is I'll take ih cross common, okay. So what I'm going to, now we have solved this as well. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take ih cross common from these all values. So if I take ih cross common, we get p operator x operator, okay, plus from here x operator p operator, again plus p operator x operator, and from here again x operator p operator, okay. So this becomes equal to ih cross 2 p operator x operator plus 2 x operator p operator, and if I solve this, we get 2 ih cross x operator p operator plus x operator p operator, and this is what the answer is. So I took 2 common and we got this as the answer. Now it might be looking lengthier when I'm solving, but if you sit down and solve yourself, it will not take you more than 50-60 seconds to solve, maximum 1 minute. And this was a 4 marker from CSI Net Physics 2012. So you just solved a physics question of commutators, right? So I hope with this solving this particular question, you got some confidence in the commutator problems. And there are two more problems that we need to discuss, which are again very important, that are based on angular momentum, okay? That is Lx and Ly, commutator of Lx and Ly, and then there is another one where it's commutator of L square and Ly. So these two are also very important. They have been asked quite a few times in the exam, and they're more likely to be asked in the exam because these are little complex commutators. So simple ones, these people, I mean the examiners, have been asking for a very long time. So I'm hoping that they might just give you some questions based on your angular momentum operators, because they take a little while to solve, and there's no shortcut as well. I mean, there is a shortcut which obviously I'm going to tell you, but I want you to first solve those questions and then I'll tell you the shortcut, right? So put some effort in solving those questions and definitely I'll then tell you the shortcut. Shortcuts are useful when you know the concept. So once you know the concept, I don't have any problem in telling you the shortcut. But yes, It bothers me when I tell you the shortcut without actually telling you the concept, because that way I feel that you'll become very lazy, right? Because you, if you have the answers with you, you will not try and learn the concept, and that won't be beneficial for you. So you'll crack the exam, but you would know nothing as such. So you will not be able to get into good institutes, because in the interview they'll catch you, right? So this is already a 30-minute video. So the angular momentum part I'm going to cover in the next part of this video, like next lecture. I think it will be lecture 6 or 7. I'm not sure the next one. So whichever it is, I'll help you out in that particular lecture, right? So I hope that this video was quite beneficial to you. I'm really hopeful, because I did put in a lot of efforts and I tried to simplify as much as possible. And I did teach to a few students as well these concepts, and they really liked it. So I hope you also like it a lot. So give this video a big thumbs up. Please do subscribe to my channel and do share it with your friends. Sometimes what happens is, if you understand a very good concept, you suddenly feel that if I share this video, everyone else will understand this concept. But that's not a very good perspective, because the more you share, and I'll tell you this out of my personal experience, that the more you share your concepts, your short tricks with your friends, trust me, you'll get even more short tricks to learn. All right, so the more you share, the more you're going to gain. All right, the more you share, the more you're going to gain. So I please request you, if you found this video helpful, do share it to your friends who are not able to understand this particular concept. And please subscribe to my channel, because that motivates me and that keeps me going and keeps helping me to give you good content like this, right? So anyway, thank you so much for watching. All the very best and good luck.